Ace of Shun. I found it. It took a while. This is the first Dungeons and Dragons video I'd ever seen on YouTube. First one of its kind. This is 2006. It's been, I want to say it's been 12 years since I've seen this video. And I remember, you know, watching this on dial-up, and I'm thinking, the guy acts like he's under duress. He's explaining these dice, he's sweating bullets, and he looks like he has a gun pointed to his head. So I'm curious if that's still the case. Or was I imaginating things?
There are several different types of multi-sided dice that you'll need to use in a Dungeons & Dragons game. These will determine what happens when your character attempts to take some action in the game, such as fighting, convincing a non-player character to do something, or almost anything can come down to a dice roll. So your basic dice are, first and foremost,
I don't think he's reading, but he seems nervous. I mean, he should be. He's making the very first D&D video for YouTube.
Your 20-sided die. A 20-sided die is sort of the core of the Dungeons & Dragons system. It's also called the...
This is Patient Zero? I mean, now we have Guy, and we have Matt Colville. We have DM Lair. We have the Professor Dungeon Craft Dude, whatever that guy's name is. You got Quest Beast. You got the, what's another one? The various, RPG PhD types. You know, RPG Musings, RPG Dungeoning, RPG, you know, those things. Then you have all the performers, the online performers, like Critical Role and stuff. This guy here, he was the first. This is... No one had come before him. He did not know how to explain D&D for mass audience. Let's start a little back. These are short... He's got like 100 of these things, and they're all short videos. But he's like totally serious. He probably has no idea who might even... Who will even watch? Who will even watch this video?
One player character to do something, or almost anything, can come down to a dice roll. So your basic dice are, first and foremost, your 20-sided die. A 20-sided... die is sort of the core of the Dungeons & Dragons system. It's also called the D20 system. D being...
See, already he's got the lighting. He has the lighting going on. He's got the outfits, the shields, the swords. He's got someone with the camcorder, whatever, helping out with the videography. Someone's doing the video editing. High production. This is high production. Compared to the static camera most people have, doesn't move, and everyone's got the ring lights behind the cameras.
An abbreviation for die or dice. After the 20-sided die, very common is the 6-sided die. This is the die that would determine your character's ability scores, as you know, and
3D6?
Certain weapon rolls during combat would be determined by this die. There is also a 12-sided die, probably the least commonly used in the
game.
No
one uses that one.
A 10-sided die used in certain weapon rolls, and a 4-sided die, an 8-sided die, and then the infamous 100-sided die, which is sometimes looks like a pretty much like a golf ball, but in this case we have another 10-sided die that we would roll together with our 100-sided die, and you can see that if you roll a 30 and a 2, that would give you a roll of 32. Dice usage is very simple. You just roll it and you have your score. Now you know enough to start playing with multi-sided dice in Dungeons & Dragons.
Wow. Let's watch another one.
Today we're going to talk about the history of Dungeons & Dragons. Dungeons & Dragons is a role-playing game. It was invented in 1974 by Gary Gygax and Dave Arnson. The game was originally published by their company, TSR. It's now published by Wizards of the Coast, which is a subsidiary.
I commend their efforts into resizing the video. These videos were 320 by 200. So someone decided, hey, 4x3, let's do it. Post them on YouTube. Get those AVIs on YouTube.
...of Hasbro. Dungeons & Dragons inherits from miniature war and strategy games, board games, and, of course, good old-fashioned storytelling around a campfire. It was first made popular in the latter part of the 1970s. It's been through several editions up to the current edition, which is edition 3.5. And that's a little bit about the history of Dungeons & Dragons.
That's great. Awesome. Next.
And to create a Dungeons & Dragons character, you'll want to have a player's handbook, multi-sided dice, a character sheet, and your dungeon master will tell you what dice rolling method you'll use to come up with your character's ability scores. There are several different types of characters, characters such as wizards, fighters, rogues, and depending on what your ability scores are, your character might be more suited for a different, you know, occupation, such as a thief if he has high dexterity. And so once you've done your dice...
Is this guy famous now? This is almost 20 years ago. Is this guy famous? Does anyone know who he is? Does he have a YouTube channel? Or is he just doing public access stuff for college?
Roles, you can figure that out. Come up with an ability score, you would normally roll 3 six-sided dice and add up the numbers, and the first roll would be your strength. So here we would write our strength, and then we would do the same thing for dexterity, constitution, intelligence, wisdom, and charisma until we have all of our ability scores.
Hang on. Whoa, hang on. What am I looking at here? 16, 14, 12? Really? Those are some good rolls, if that's what I'm seeing. If that's what I'm looking at, I don't know what he's looking at here. His is already filled in.
We would select a class, such as fighter. That would be your sword fighting class. And this character will stick with you hopefully through several Dungeons & Dragons gaming sessions, possibly through a whole, you know, years-long campaign. So you put care into these characters and make them something that you can role-play.
Care to explain what role-play is? I'm sure he's got a video. He'll explain in 1 minute.
And now you know a little bit about creating characters in Dungeons & Dragons. Your game pieces are optional in the Dungeons & Dragons game. They're more emphasized in the later editions especially, but they're a fun thing to do regardless of what edition of Dungeons & Dragons you're playing. Your game board adds a visual element to the game, helps you keep track of where players and monsters and non-player characters.
He's having fun. I can tell.
Are on the, in relation to each other. So here we have an example of a dungeon. This is a commercially made map, but you can also make your own. You can even make them out of styrofoam and things just like you would make a model train.
Human skin.
Set. But this is a commercially made map, and let's just say that we've got some players in this little room here. So here we've got two swordsmen and then this fellow. These are some figurines that I painted myself a while back. And unbeknownst to them, just a couple rooms away, there might be some monsters hanging out waiting to hack them up with their axes or some other horrific fate that's in store for them. And you can see, you know, you would just be able to move these characters around on the board. The characters would either have a set number of moves that they could make each turn.
He's playing Rogue. I've seen this game. It's called Rogue. It's on the computer.
Turn, or you could roll a dice, a die such as a 10-sided die to see how far they go in that round. And
oh, that's Clue. He just did some Clue right there.
Once they're close enough to start fighting, then we get the fighting part of the dungeon, and we get to defeat all of their enemies. So it's a good way to...
He is stressed out. Someone is forcing him under duress to make these videos.
Again, add that visual element to your game, and it just makes it that much more enjoyable. So try it out in your game.
No.
I will.
Adventures are made by the Dungeon Master and played with the Dungeon Master and, of course, the players playing their characters. Essential tools for adventure making are some sort of a blank book, such as a notebook.
Graph paper.
Possibly some graph paper. Character sheets so that you can record non-player characters, some pencil.
Oh no. The video stopped.
A notebook, possibly some graph paper, character sheets so that you can record non-player characters, some pencil.
Oh no! This is bad.
Knowledge of cartography, which is the art and science of maps, some knowledge of the campaign setting that you might be playing in. If you like to hand draw your maps, of course you can do that, but they also have software such as Campaign Cartographer, which has been published for many years by Pro Fantasy Software.
I have that.
And you might want to look in.
I have that. I got the bundle of holding. It was super cheap. Haven't gotten around to learning how to use it though. It looks interesting.
Into buying that to make more detailed maps for your campaigns. Now you're ready to create some adventures and hopefully host many good games.
Wow.
Now, a non-player character in Dungeons & Dragons is one that's not directly controlled by one of the players. Generally, they would be controlled by the Dungeon Master. A henchman is a character who is not directly controlled by a player, but they're normally assigned to a player. So, an example of a henchman would be the best friend of your character, where the best friend of that character is not played by another player, but it's played partially by the Dungeon Master, but also partial control is usually given to the player whose henchman it is. Non-player characters are very important to a Dungeons & Dragons game. Most of the humans, so to speak, that you would interact with in a game would be of the non-player sort. They would be made up by the Dungeon Master and controlled by him or her. And henchmen are a good way to keep a game interesting. Sometimes they might refuse to do what you think they're going to do, and they can just add a little bit of variety and fun to, you know, the game and the interactions with the characters.
I'll have to take his word for it.
The Dungeon Master is the main story teller of a Dungeons and Dragons game. He or she is the person who determines what happens after characters or after players say what their characters are doing, roll their dice.
Did I see this one already? It's hard to tell. It's all a blur. After a while, it's all a blur.
The Dungeon Master is almost playing against the characters, but really he's also playing with the characters. One of the main tools of the Dungeon Master is the Dungeon Master's Guide. You can see here I have a classic Dungeon Master's Guide, and this would contain all of the rules that you would need to know as a Dungeon Master. Here also is a more current Dungeon Master's Guide, and one other tool of the dungeon.
He's trying not to mess up. He's making the first D&D video for YouTube ever.
Master would be the Dungeon Master's screen. This is something that you can put up to block what you're doing so that players can't see it. And it also has reference materials on the backside so that you have easy access to some of the Dungeon Master rules. So now that you know a little bit about the Dungeon Master, you're ready to start your own Dungeons and Dragons.
Hey, no pressure. He spends a minute telling you what a DM does, and it's like, okay, now have at it. Good luck.
Combat in Dungeons and Dragons normally takes place in with dice rolls. So depending on what version of the game you're playing, you might be using slightly different dice. But in all versions, if you are attacking,
the luck die,
you'll use a 20-sided die, and a higher number will be better. And if the number is higher, you're more likely to hit your enemy and cause damage to them.
I mean, actually hit them. Like, not just hit their armor, but hit the meaty tissue inside the armor.
Of course, once you know whether or not you're successful, you can roll a die for damage. So let's just say that we're rolling this one, and we come up with a 6. We would be doing 6 damage to the hit points.
Yeah. And let's say this thing's got 900 hit points. You're going to be doing this all day.
Of the enemy. If the enemy hits us and rolls a 6, they'll be doing 6 points of damage to our hit points or life points. Which means that we'll be that much closer to our character perishing, unfortunately. sometimes in a battle, or if your character is afflicted with some sort of trap or disease, you might have to roll a saving throw. The saving throw rules are different from version to version. In third edition, you might have a saving throw against fortitude or...
This must be a job interview that was being recorded. That's probably what this is. He wants to work for a game company or something, and they want to know how much he knows about D&D.
Willpower. In the second and first editions, saving throws, there are several more categories. For example, poison, paralyzation, and death magic. The way they work is you'll consult the player's handbook for the version that you're using of Dungeons and Dragons, and if I was rolling a saving throw against poison, I would roll the 20-sided die, and I would hope for a lower number, because a lower number would be better, and I would be more likely not to be afflicted by that poison.
These videos, they're degrading, I can tell. They're old. YouTube, the old videos are degrading. If these videos disintegrate, just disappear from the server, guess what happens? The people in the videos die too.
Beyond that, there are a few other game mechanics that you should just get the details out of the guides, the player's handbook and the Dungeon Master's Guide. And once you memorize those rules a little bit better, you won't have to refer to the book over and over again, and you can have a nice, smooth game session without pausing.
I've heard this before. It's a trap. Combat goes on for hours. It doesn't matter how long you've played the game. In fact, the more you've played the game, the longer the combat gets because you're experienced in combat.
All the time during the battles.
Next. One more.
Let's talk about more tools for dungeon masters. These would be tools that would help you to make good campaigns, good adventures, and just good fun for your players. Things that you'll want to look into
Is there a tool for finding good players?
to enrich your game are history books, such as books on medieval history.
History books, such as the Player's Handbook, the Monster Manual, the Monster Compendium. Yeah, history books. These technically, yeah, these are history books now.
History, folklore, and things like that. It's also worth looking into
Lord of the
mythology
Rings.
books, doing some research on ancient religions and things like that, since the Dungeons and Dragons realms often incorporate
Since the Jygax wrote from those things.
great mythological elements into them. And you'll also benefit from picking up some adventure books or story books with classic medieval settings, usually such as the Merry Adventures of Robin Hood or something
In color.
similar to that, that have adventures and just fun story elements that maybe you can copy.
Prince Valiant, Flash Gordon, the original stuff from the 30s.
Copy and incorporate into your campaign world. So try that out when you're dungeon mastering, and I hope that works out for you.
It shall.